a place called North Carolina. And I have these incredible women from North Carolina right over there. And they've been to, I shouldn't tell you, 129 different rallies. Can you believe it? Look how great they look. And their husbands love them. I don't know how the husbands do this. They travel all over, and finally we have one in North Carolina, nice and easy. It's nice and easy for you. No, they're incredible people. 129 rallies, it's great. But it's really tremendous to be back in this beautiful state with thousands and thousands of proud, hardworking American patriots, which is what you are. This is a nice arena. How about the people outside that can't get in? That's a lot of people, too. Would anybody like to give up your seat? Would anybody? You're just not generous people. As you know, 3 days ago, we officially defeated the worst president in the history of our country, Crooked Joe Biden. He quit because he was losing so badly in the polls. He was down in every single poll and down by a lot, so he quit. But really, what happened was the leaders of the Democrat Party, in a very undemocratic move, the bosses, they said, either you get out or we're going to throw you out using the 25th Amendment. That's what happened. You know that. So, well, you know that. That's what happens. That's what happens. These are nasty people, the Democrats, so we better beat them or we're not going to have a country left. You're not going to have a country left. So now we have a new victim to defeat. Lion Kamala Harris, Lion, L-Y-I-N apostrophe. The most incompetent and far-left vice president in American history. By the way, they did a poll. She was rated the worst vice president in history. I've never seen that poll before, but that's the poll. Together, we will win North Carolina in an epic landslide. We're way ahead in the poll. And we will take back that beautiful White House, and we will very simply make America great again. For 3.5 years, Lion Kamala Harris has been the ultra-liberal driving force behind every single Biden catastrophe. She is a radical left lunatic who will destroy our country. If she ever gets the chance to get into office, we're not going to let that happen. You know, I was supposed to be nice. They say something happened to me when I got shot. I became nice. And when you're dealing with these people, they're very dangerous people. When you're dealing with them, you can't be too nice. You really can't be. So if you don't mind, I'm not going to be nice. Is that okay? I'm not. They want me to be nice. Thank you. Kamala Harris is the most liberal elected politician in American history. Did you know that? She's an ultra-liberal politician. She's absolutely terrible. She's, as you know, more liberal than Bernie Sanders. Can you believe it? She's rated far more liberal than Bernie Sanders. And she's now trying to get rid of her record, but she can't. She's going out and saying things that she doesn't believe in. If she ever got in, she'd destroy this country so fast. So she was the border czar, but she never went to the border, right? She never. She was appointed by this horrible president, this horrible guy. How this guy got to be president in his basement. He stayed in his basement. And we did a lot better the second time than we did the first. How this guy got to be president, what they've done to this country in 3.5 years, and we're going to turn it around. But what they've done to our country is unthinkable. as borders are, Kamala threw open our borders and allowed 20 million illegal aliens to stampede into our country from all over the world. As vice president, she cast the tie-breaking votes that created the worst inflation in a half a century, decimating middle-class families and hurting very badly, as you know, all people in North Carolina. And by the way, Laura says hello. Laura, do we love Laura? How good is Laura? She is terrific. She has done a tremendous job. You know, I'm saying it now because if I forget it later on, they'll say he's cognitively challenged. I don't want to be cognitively, no, but I want to thank her because she's unbelievable. She loves it. I'll introduce Michael in a couple of minutes, but I want to remember to introduce Laura. She's been a fantastic daughter-in-law and wife to Eric. And she happened to name her one beautiful daughter, you know what? Carolina. Carolina. I said, which one? Which Carolina? She said, well, North, of course. No. Let's call them both. Do you mind if I call them both? They've both been great, frankly. And when Kamala Harris was sent to Europe to deter Russia, what a joke that was, from attacking Ukraine, how did that work out? Russia answered by launching the invasion just 5 days after she left. Putin laughed at her like she was nothing. She is nothing. She's going to be, she's so bad for us. Everything Kamala touches turns into a total disaster. She's destroyed San Francisco with her policies. Check out San Francisco. 20 years ago, it was the greatest city in our country. Today, it's not a livable city. She'll destroy our country if she's elected, so we won't let her be elected. We can't let that happen. Unbelievably, despite all of the damage she's caused, radical liberal Kamala Harris now wants a promotion to deliver 4 more years of chaos. We've had the worst 4 years. You know, I say about Biden, if you took the 10 worst presidents in the history of our country, added them up, they won't have done the damage that crooked Joe Biden has done. But this November, the American people are going to tell her, no thanks, Kamala. You've done a terrible job. You've been terrible at everything you've done. You're ultra-liberal, that we don't want you here. We don't want you anywhere. Kamala, you're fired. Get out of here. You're fired. And yet the fake news, which a month ago said she was incompetent, said she was a stiff, just a dopey stiff, the worst. Nobody talked to her. She was firing her staff left and right. The staff hates her. Oh, wait till you see the stories that are going to come out about her staff. Oh, if that were me, they'd be all over the place. But the fake news tries to cover her up. But wait till you see, she was the worst with the staff of anybody. But the fake news is talking about lying Kamala as if she's the savior of our country. That she's so brave. I've never seen a turnaround like this. I mean, 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago, she was the worst politician in America. Now they say, isn't it amazing? Look at her. She's so beautiful. She's so magnificent. She has a crowd of 1,000 people the other day. And the fake news, and they worked hard to get that crowd. We have crowds of 25, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70,000 people. And the fake news said, oh, her crowd was amazing. It was amazing. You see it? The other day, she had maybe 1,000 people. I doubt it. They worked their asses off to get those people to go, and I wonder what they gave up. They said, oh, this is such a big crowd. She's got such momentum. I don't think she's going to have a lot of momentum after this speech because I'm telling you about her, right? We're telling you the facts. I'm just giving you the facts. But they said it was such a big crowd, such a beautiful crowd. They never mention our crowds. Like this crowd. Look at this crowd. You can multiply her crowds times 20 and 30, and she wouldn't get what we get. 107,000 people recently in New Jersey. We might win New Jersey. We're up in New Jersey. 82,000 in South Carolina. 82,000. And by the way, we would have had a number here that would have been through the roof. But, you know, we are confined. As beautiful as this arena is, I just met the owner. He said it's an all-time record. Because, you know, they have basketball, hockey. But with basketball, hockey, you can't fill up the floors, right? So we set the all-time record. And it's he's a very nice gentleman, great family. But we set the all-time record. And if this thing were twice as large, it would be filled up with the people outside. 68,000 people in the great state of Alabama, 68,000. And then we did one in the South Bronx, and that can be a rough place. But we did one, and it was like a love fest. This was an amazing thing. We had 25,000 people in the South Bronx. Amazing. And if I ever had a crowd like Kamala, assuming she had 2,000 people, assuming, which I don't think she did. But if I ever had a crowd, they'd do headline stories. Trump is over. It's all over. It's not working for him anymore. They never mention the crowd. I tell those, look at all those cameras back there. Look. And I always say, but they never do it, turn the cameras around to show them the crowd, but they never do it. They never want to do it. They just don't want to do it. They don't want to do it. I don't know why. Even the semi-friendly camera, they don't turn. You know, I used to think it was a physical thing with the camera. You know, the steel, you can't turn. And in 2015, it started right from the beginning, these big crowds. But now I have to tell you, there's more spirit now. We won in 2016. We did much better in 2020, but it was rigged. It was rigged. But this is bigger than 2020. This is bigger than 2016. And I think the reason is you like me a lot, but you know what you really like? When you look at the incompetent administration that we have with the inflation, with the Afghanistan, with all of the things they've done wrong, everything, the borders are. When you look at how bad they are, you say, you know, I like Trump, but now I really like Trump because we don't want to go back. Front row Joes. Front row Joes. You know, front row Joes, they've been to 201. I hate to tell you that, North Carolina. They beat you, 201. And they were to a rough one last week. That was a rough one. I saw them. They were sitting in the front row and things were happening that weren't too nice, right? Amazing, right? But they were there. They were there and they didn't move. You know, amazing. Nobody moved. When a bullet goes off, this is a freak thing, but a bullet goes off, crowds always run. They run. They call it a stampede. Nobody ran. And we had 55,000 people. Nobody ran. You could see the small group we had behind. And, no, you could see the group behind because the camera was on. We had a tremendous, you know, like hundreds of people from the press. We had cameras going on. And you could see behind me, they were like this. How about the guy right behind me in the black with the green hat? And he's looking like this. That guy was, I want to meet him. But they had a lot of guys like that back there. But did you see him? They've only played that clip about 5,000 times. They see it every day. It's over and over. But you see how brave. Normally, when something like that happens, everybody but Richard will leave. Richard will stay. He's a tough cookie. But no, everybody scrambles. They run. Nobody ran. Same thing with the group out front. The group out front was the big group. Thousands and thousands of people. Nobody left. They just stood there watching because they saw that I was in trouble. Either I was in trouble or something was happening because I had a lot of blood on my hand. I checked out. I said, oh, yay, what's this? But no, they saw that. And when I went down, they saw that and nobody left. It was like the whole thing is like a big love fest. Let's face it. It's a whole big love fest. It's amazing. We love you, man. We love you. We love you. We love you. That was a horrible thing. That was a rough thing. And say what you want, the Secret Service, the ones on this day, on the dais, these guys right here, the tough cookies, they ran. Bullets were flying. Bullets were flying, and they were running right at me. And it was a rough, horrible, horrible time. And they said, sir, we have a stretcher for you. I said, you're not putting me. I'm not getting on a stretcher. They had a stretcher. I said, that's not going to look very good if I get carried out on a stretcher. Hello, everybody. Thank you, everybody. They said, I'm not getting. Where are my shoes? My shoes got knocked off. They tackled me so damn hard. But it was a terrible thing in so many ways. And as you know, we lost somebody who was fantastic. Corey, fantastic. His family is fantastic. And two other great people. These are great people. I got to know their families a little bit. And, you know, the public has really been generous to them, too. They opened up their hearts. I won't even tell you. The numbers are so incredible. But they opened up their hearts to the three of them. And these two were hurt very badly. But they're both now in pretty good shape. They'll soon be in very good shape. So, But I just looked down here at Front Row Joe's, and it just reminded me of that incident a week and a half ago, right? You were right there watching it. You saw it. And you guys, by the way, weren't moving either. I saw you. You didn't move. You were just — they were standing just like they're standing right now. They were standing. They were — they're great. They're great. And sad. Such a distressed, sick world. But, you know, it could be caused when they call you a threat to democracy. You never know what causes it. I'm a threat to them. They're a threat to democracy. They're a threat to our country, period. But that was some time we had. That was some rough time. But it was incredible. The people I got to know through that, I got to know some unbelievable and really brave people. But the next time they show that clip, which will be as soon as you get home. They'll show it about 30 times. They show it every day over and over. But watch the people behind. They always stampede. If a bullet goes off or something happens in a soccer stadium or a stadium, and we had more people than most of those stadiums would have, everyone runs. Nobody ran. They stayed, and they — and you have to look. The one guy, it just was so — he just was so angry. He's looking. I gotta meet him. There's something about brave people that I love, right? People that love our country. He's out there. He's like up there, up there. No, they're great. They're great people. And we had a great convention. We had a great convention. We had a convention that broke all television ratings. How good was the Hulkster, right? Oh. And Kid Rock called. He wanted to be a part. He was fantastic. But they were all fantastic. It was the greatest. It was just a flawless convention. It was great. And the television ratings were record-setting ratings. Record. You all read that. They were record-setting ratings. And it was just an honor. The stadium was beautiful. Milwaukee was beautiful. Wisconsin's promised me they're all going to vote for me now because we put $250 million into their economy. So we're going to win. the great state of Wisconsin. But Milwaukee was great. They did a great job. The stadium is new. They built it for the basketball team, which is excellent. You know the Greek, right? The Greek. He's a good player. But they built it for the team, and it was like new. And it was one of the most — I think it was the greatest. I really believe it. It couldn't have been better. It was the greatest convention that anyone's seen thus far, Republican or Democrat. But getting back to a subject called Kamala, who's the worst? You know, I ask you this question because this has never happened before. So Biden's running. I wouldn't say his debate performance was one of the best, right? Do you agree? That's where it all started with the debate. The downfall started that night with the debate. The debate was like, that was a rough debate. He said, yeah, I had a bad night. No, he had a bad night. He had a bad everything. He had a very bad night. But it started, really, with the debate. It was all, you know, the game was up. They say the jig was up. And it was indeed up. But it started with that. And then it only got worse. And we were leading him by 11, 12, 14, 15 points. And then he decides to get out because the bosses said, we're not going to have you. He didn't want to get out. But they told him, you're getting out. They said, you're getting out. You're getting killed in the polls. You can't win. You saw that. You can't win. You're getting killed. So now they bring in this one who's worse than him. She's worse than him. Because he's a fake liberal. You know, he wasn't that liberal. He was fake. She's a real liberal. She really is a real liberal. She's much worse than him. Now, if we start beating her in the polls by 10 or 15 points, are they going to bring in a third candidate? It's like, you know, Trump is killing this guy. All right, out. Let's bring in a new one. Out. Out. And then maybe at some point they get one right. But when will that stop? And, you know, the guy had 14 million votes. So much for democracy. You know, they talk about democracy. He had 14 million votes, and they said, we're going to give it to somebody with no votes. She had no votes. In addition to her horrendous record as vice president, Kamala Harris has also been caught red-handed perpetrating the biggest scandal in American political history. For 3.5 years, Harris shamelessly lied to the public to cover up Joe Biden's mental unfitness, claiming that Crooked Joe was at the absolute top of his game. I don't think so. I don't think so. I wish him well, but I don't like him. He's not a nice person. I mean, he's not a nice person. He's trying to put me in jail. Why would I like him, right? That's the first time. Oh, first time. And she's the one behind it. And she's got a new line, you know? She's going, I'm the prosecutor. She's one of the worst prosecutors in history. She destroyed San Francisco. I'm the prosecutor, and he's the convicted felon or something. A radical left judge in an area where every one of these cases, every one of them is brought by them. So think of it. They get me to that position, and then their campaign says, I'm the prosecutor, and he is the convicted felon. That's their campaign. I don't think people are going to buy it. And we won our big case. You know, we won the case in Florida. That was a big one. We won that one. And I got out by beating their Justice Department. And he got out of the same case, except his was far different because he had 50 years of documents, right? He got out by being incompetent. The prosecutor said he had no memory. He basically said he's incompetent, so he shouldn't stand trial. Can you imagine? He can be president, but he can't stand trial. What's that about? But no, but it was all headed up by her because she's a prosecutor, a really bad one. If Kamala will lie to you so brazenly about Joe Biden's mental incapacity, then she will lie to you about anything. She can never, ever be trusted. She can't be trusted. And just like Crooked Joe Biden, Kamala Harris is unfit to lead. She's unfit to lead. She'll destroy our country. In a year, this country will be destroyed. A vote for Kamala is a vote for 4 more years of dishonesty, incompetence, weakness, and failure. Other than that, she's doing an excellent job. A vote for Trump Vance. How do you like? How do you like? J.D. Vance. How do you like him? A vote for Trump Vance administration is a vote to restore leadership, competence, common sense, and strength back to the Oval Office like we had it just 3.5 years ago. If Kamala Harris gets in, she would be the most radical far-left extremist ever to occupy the White House times 10. There's never been a lunatic like this in the White House, and we've had some bad ones. But the worst one is Joe, actually. As a senator, Harris was ranked the number one most left-wing Democrat in the Senate. Think of that. She's ranked the number one. That's not what this country wants. She makes Bernie look like a moderate. You know, he looks like Bernie Sanders. He's actually quite moderate by comparison. Here's just some of her crazy liberal record. Kamala Harris co-sponsored Bernie Sanders' $32 trillion plan for a socialist takeover of the entire U.S. health system, which will be a disaster and will bankrupt Medicare and Social Security. They're gone. And remember, Social Security is going to be gone anywhere if we're not elected, because they're putting all of these millions of people that are pouring into our country, they're putting them into Social Security, Medicare, schools, hospitals. And we all have a big heart, but some of those people are tough, from prisons, from mental institutions, terrorists. When asked if her plan would outlaw private health insurance for 180 million Americans, Kamala replied, "Let's just eliminate all of it." That's all she said. "We'll eliminate all." Oh, that's nice. Thank you very much, Kamala. She endorsed free taxpayer-funded government health care for all illegal aliens, everybody that walks into our country that's illegal. This is why they come. When these stupid people, they're stupid, low IQ people, when they say, "We're going to give you health care, we're going to give you everything," they come. You're not going to say, "We're going to give you all of these things." They're going to come, even if they're fine in their country. And people are being killed in the caravans, especially women. They're dying on the way up. It's horrible. It's horrible. You have to see the real numbers. She co-sponsored the $100 trillion Green New Scam with the goal of completely abolishing the oil, coal, and natural gas industries, which would reduce the United States to a third world country. No more oil, no more gasoline. Good luck with your electric car that goes for about 45 minutes before you have to get it. Do you know someplace like in the Midwest, did you see? They built 8 chargers. You know, a charge, like, it's sort of like the equivalent of a gas pump. They built 8 chargers for $9 billion. And 2 of them don't work. That's a big problem. And if we were going to charge up the entire country for the electric car, if we were going to charge up, it would cost $5 trillion. That's more money than we would have. We would have to file for bankruptcy. And they don't care. They say, "Let's do it anyway." She said that a 70 to 80% tax hike is, quote, a bold idea that should be discussed. She wants an 80%. You know, I gave you the largest tax cuts in history. She wants to take them away and increase your taxes. I don't think you're going to be too happy. Kamala publicly boasted, quote, "There's no question I'm in favor of banning fracking." She wants no fracking. Now, that pertains to Pennsylvania, Texas. It pertains to Oklahoma. It pertains to a lot of other places, more so than you. But it pertains to you where your wallet, because you're going to be paying a lot of money. You're going to be paying so much. You're going to say, "Bring back Trump, please, please. Please bring back Trump. We want Trump. We want some common sense, please." She supports mandatory gun confiscation to rip firearms out of the hands of millions of law-abiding gun owners. She wants to take away your Second Amendment, which we need. Lion Kamala is also a total radical on a word called do you know this, right? A word called what? Abortion. She's a radical, crazy person. When you compare my position on abortion to that of Kamala Harris, my position is 8 points higher in the polls, and that's because she is so radical. She wants abortions in the 8th and 9th month of pregnancy. That's fine with her. Right up until birth. And even after birth, the execution of a baby. Because that's not abortion. That's the execution of a baby. You remember the governor? You remember the former governor? The current governor is excellent. The former governor of Virginia, he said, yes, we may have the baby, and then we decide with the mother what to do with the baby. This is after the baby is born now. She supports that. She supports taxpayer funds to pay for abortion for any reason whatsoever. She even voted against legislation that would require medical providers to give care to babies born alive after an attempted abortion. Think of that one. Whereas our position is that abortion is now back to the states. You know, for 52 years, they've wanted to bring it's Roe v. Wade. They wanted to bring it back to the states. It wasn't about how many weeks and how many. Everybody wanted it. Every legal scholar, every Democrat, every Republican, liberals, conservatives, they wanted it brought back to the states. And because we had a very brave 6 people on the Supreme Court of the United States, so they were very brave. After 52 years, they allowed it. But everybody wanted it. And they were brave to do it. And now it's up to the will of the people in each state. And it's happening in Ohio. They voted. And frankly, it came out to be more of a liberal policy, but they voted. And it's getting back in Kansas. You saw what happened there. Somewhat of a liberal policy. Texas goes and Alabama goes and other states. But it's all being voted on by the states. It's back in the hands of the people. And the state returns the age-old question to where it belongs. And it belongs with the people, and it belongs over time, and you see what's happening, and you see how it's working out. Like Ronald Reagan, very importantly, I happen to support, you have to go with your heart, but I happen to support the 3 exceptions, rape, incest, and the life of the mother. I think that's the way. But follow your heart. But you also have to remember, you have to get elected. You have to remember, because we have elections, and elections are about a lot of other things, too, that are very important. But you have to get elected. But Ronald Reagan was for that. I was for that, the 3 exceptions. And as Vice President, Kamala Harris cast the tie-breaking vote to cut, as you know, Medicare by $273 billion. She cast a vote to cut Medicare. Nobody knows that. She doesn't want people to know that. Now what she's doing is she's running away from Israel. She refuses to go to Bibi Netanyahu is in Washington. She refuses to go there. Even if you're against Israel or you're against the Jewish people, show up and listen to the concept. But she's totally against the Jewish people. And it amazes me how Jewish people will vote for the Democrats when they're being treated so disrespectfully and badly. It amazes me. It's shocking. I don't get it. Kamala even wants to pass laws to outlaw red meat to stop climate change. And she is. You know what that means? That means no more cows. You know, this is serious. No, this means no more cows. I guess eventually she's going to mean no more people, right? No more people. So if you want socialist health care, nation-wrecking inflation, the death of American energy, and a lying radical-left liberal San Francisco extremist as your commander-in-chief, then Kamala Harris is your candidate. She's the one for you. Just like she destroyed San Francisco, she will destroy our entire country. And let me tell you, it's in pretty bad shape right now anyway. What they've done in 3.5 years, especially, I mean, think of Afghanistan, the most embarrassing moment, day in the history of our country. We got out of weakness. We were going to get out, but we were going to get out of strength and dignity. We were going to get out. They left, you know, $85 billion worth of brand new equipment, brand new, beautiful military equipment. I rebuilt the military. They got equipment that I bought, and they left it in Afghanistan. And you know that Afghanistan now, the Taliban, Afghanistan is the 2nd or 3rd largest seller of military equipment in the world. They're taking this gorgeous stuff, and they're selling it, and they're making a fortune because they don't need 700,000 rifles and guns. They don't need 77,000 trucks and cars. Many of them are built with all steel bottoms. They're all guarded up for the horrible bombs that they had to endure. They're all very expensive. These are very expensive things. And they're selling them now because they just need a tiny fraction of what they were left. We were going to take it all out. We were going to keep Bagram, the big air base. We had 13 soldiers killed. We had 47 soldiers horribly, horribly hurt. No legs, no arms. Nobody ever talks about them. They talk about the 13 dead. They never talk about the 47 that have been so horribly hurt. I mean, just it's so bad. It's so horrible to see. But 47 is an important number. Maybe there's something to it. You know, 47, that's an important number. And basically, she's a very bad person, and she shouldn't be running for president. She is a threat to democracy, a true threat to democracy. She'll destroy our nation. But if you want no inflation, low gas prices, how about $1.87? And we had it actually lower than that. If you want energy independence, and even now, energy dominance, we're going to be dominant. You know, you have to see the chart. And my favorite chart of all, of course, some of you would understand what I mean, was the immigration chart. Because I looked over and I said, look at that chart! Does anybody know what I'm talking about? It's my all-time favorite chart. Man, am I lucky to show that chart? I said, let me see that chart. Let me see that chart! Pull it down! That was it, good. That's my all-time favorite chart. It showed how great we did on immigration. My last week in office, we had the lowest number of illegal aliens that we ever had coming across our border. I was very proud of the chart. You see it go like this, and then it goes like a skyrocket. But forget that. I like it for other reasons, too. I will sleep with that chart for the rest of my life. But if you want the greatest economy in history again, and freedom, if you want freedom, real freedom, because we're going in a very bad direction, then you must vote for a gentleman named, perhaps you've heard of him, Donald J. Trump. Perhaps you've heard. Gotta get out there. Kamala Harris's California socialism would kill the American dream forever. You know, you don't hear about the American dream anymore. We're gonna bring back the American dream for our children. Under Trump Vance administration, and he's terrific. By the way, he's been incredible. You know, he wrote the great book on workers, about how workers were being horribly taken advantage of. Became a movie, big best-selling book. Became a great movie, actually. And he's a great guy. Went to Yale Law School without any connections because his father passed away and his mother had some difficulty. And you get into Yale without any connections, that's pretty good. And he was a great student. Then he met his beautiful wife at Yale, two smart people. It's really an amazing story. Amazing. Became a senator from the great state of Ohio. Ohio loves him. So he's exactly what we want. And he's a very common sense guy. But we'll bring back that American dream bigger, better, and stronger than ever before. Bigger, better, and stronger. And remember, there's no issue in which Kamala has been more unhinged than her wild pursuit of open borders. She's crazy. She's crazy. Who could want open borders? Who could want that? It's like, who could ever want men playing in women's sports in a much smaller way? Did you see a beautiful woman volleyball player 2 weeks ago got badly hurt? I didn't know you could get hurt in volleyball, but when the ball comes back at you at 140 miles an hour, I guess that can hurt. Got knocked out. But playing with a man who transitioned. And she was a top player. She said, I've never seen a ball come at me like that. I played volleyball for a long time since I'm a little girl. I've never seen a ball, Richard, as she said, I've never seen a ball come. What about race car drivers? Do you want to have a couple of transitioned race car drivers? Maybe that's okay. Actually, that could work. That could work. I have a good one for you I'd like to recommend. That could work, maybe. But she said, I've never seen a ball come. Or the weightlifting record. You see what's happening there? For 18 years, they had a record. 18 years. A quarter of an ounce and a quarter of an ounce on the barbells, right? A quarter of an ounce. Little tiny thing. And she goes, oh. Olympic tryouts. Mom and Dad are in the front. And I hate to do it. You know, my wife says it's so unprecedented when you do that. Can you believe it? So I'm embarrassed. I used to give it a big push, but now I'm embarrassed. You know, I know I'm embarrassed to do it. She said, darling, your speech was wonderful, but please do stop with the weightlifting and the swimming. It's so unprecedented. You know, she's a class act. But I said, but people like it. People like it. She looked good 2 weeks ago coming into that arena, right? Melania. She's a classic. Yeah, turn off your cameras for a second, okay? Boy, that's a lot of cameras. Man. No, no, they get it up and they can't quite do it. Oh. Mom, I'm sorry, Mom. And a guy comes out for the tryouts. He comes out. Have you lifted before? No. No, I haven't really tried it. Oh. Well, give it a shot. Bing, bong. Right? How crazy is it? Or the swimmers. The All-American swimmer. She's getting ready. She's going to break the record. It stood for 12 years. And she's beautiful, beautiful, strong. And she looks left and she sees all the girls she's grown up with. Because as Richard will tell you, those great, talented people, like Richard, wanted to drive race cars more than anything else. But he didn't quite have the courage to put that pedal to the floor like a couple of your competitors that we know so well, right? So instead he said, hell, I'm going to own the cars and I'm going to make a lot of money. This is too much for me, right? He had Dale Earnhardt. These guys were going around the track and Richard's driving. He said, I don't know. I can't do that. I understand. That's the way it is. But he became the best at what he did. And some others, too, that I know that are friends. It's a great — by the way, that's a great sport. That whole thing is great. How you do it is amazing. It's so amazing. We should send you into — I've always said, get some of these guys. I have a lot of friends in that world. I don't know. I think — is it Roger Penske, like, a great guy, too? Guy won — he won 20 Indianapolis 500s. This guy wins all the time. I mean, we appreciate talent. I said, let me use these guys to guide our military a little bit. When you can win so many races, that's okay, you know? You guide. Same thing with coaches. You take some of the greatest football coaches, you put them at a table. What do you like, coach? Because in its own way, it's not so much really different. But it's been sort of amazing. But she looks over left and she sees, and then she looks over right and she sees a lot of the young ladies that she grew up with, girls, the girls, and now they're mature women. They want to break this record. They want to qualify for the Olympics. And then right next to her is this giant. He's got the wingspan of Wilt the Silt Chamberlain. You know Wilt the Silt, 7'2", the longest arms ever recorded. And she looks and she goes, oh, oh, who is this? Oh, he transitioned. And he's in the swimming contest. He's in the meet. And this meet is a big deal. And she's a little nervous, but she's going to break that record. And they say, on your mark, set, go. And she goes, and she goes, and she goes. But she got, as you know, very badly injured. right? You know what it was? Wind burn. She got burned by the wind. He went so fast by her, she suffered massive wind burn. We had to take her out of the plane. Massive wind burn. No, it's so crazy. Men playing in women's sports. It's demeaning. Who could want this? Who could want open borders? Who could want high taxes? Who could want high taxes? Who wants this? They have so many things. You know, we're the party of common sense because we're conservative with it, but we're the party of common sense. We have to get back to common sense. Lion Kamala supported abolishing ICE. She compared ICE agents to members of the KKK. Can you believe it? It's so disrespectful. And these guys, these people are great. I've seen them, and I've seen tapes of them, and they go into a pack of MS-13 killers out on Long Island, and they walk into that pack, and all you see is fists are flying left and right. 2 minutes later, they walk out, and they've got them by the legs, and they throw them into a paddy wagon, and we take them the hell out of our country. And she wants to get rid of them. Kamala voted in favor of deadly sanctuary cities. She supports decriminalizing illegal border crossings, and she supports mass amnesty for all illegals. Think of that. Everybody coming in right now. And many of these people are coming out of the prisons and the mental institutions. They're going to get amnesty. She wants everybody to have amnesty. Then Joe Biden made her the border czar, and that's when it really got bad. She launched a colossal illegal alien invasion of a country. She said, come on in. Remember? Then she said, remember when? Then she copied him. Don't. Everyone say, don't what? Don't. Remember, don't? Don't. Don't. On my very first day back in the White House, I will terminate every single open border policy of the Biden-Harris administration. And we will seal the border and we will stop Kamala Harris' invasion without delay. It'll happen immediately. Right? We will do it immediately. Under Border Czar Harris, illegal aliens are pouring in by the millions and millions and millions. It's going to be 20 million, maybe more than that by the end. You ever hear of gotaways? They don't include gotaways. You know what a gotaway is? The people that get in, which is probably most of them. It's probably already over 20 million. You know, we're losing 300,000 people a year to fentanyl that comes through our border. We had it down to the lowest number, and now it's worse than it's ever been. We had the best border, the most secure border we've ever had. And now, in just a short period of time, we have the worst numbers in history. They're coming not just from South America, but from Africa, from Asia, from the Middle East. They're coming from everywhere. They're coming from all over the world, from prisons and jails, mental institutions, and insane asylums. You know, they go crazy when I say the late, great Hannibal Lecter. Okay, they say, why would he mention Hannibal Lecter? He must be cognitively in trouble. No. These are real stories. Hannibal Lecter from Silence of the Lamb. He's a lovely man. He wants to have you for dinner. He'd like to have you for dinner. These people are coming into our country. And terrorists are coming in at the highest levels that we've ever seen. You know, in 2019, Border Patrol put out a chart. And I don't believe this chart, but I like it. I use it all the time. It said during 2019, we had zero terrorists. It's impossible, I think. But they said it. I'll take it. Where is Brandon? Brandon, is that right? 2019, the great Brandon Judd. 2019 from Border Patrol. 2019. They had zero terrorists coming in. Now, I think it has to be. I'm sure some got in a little bit, but not very many. But they had it down at zero, so I use that all the time. But now we have hundreds and hundreds and thousands of terrorists coming into our country, coming in from all over the world. Meanwhile, our crime rate is going up, despite the fact that they like to say it's not. Come on. while crime statistics all over the world are plunging. And you know why they're plunging? Because other countries are taking their criminal elements and they're bringing them into the United States of America, and they're dumping them in our — we're a dumping ground. We're a stupid country that's run by stupid people. And we're going to make this country so great again, but we have to fix it. In Venezuela, which was ridden with crime, crime is down 72% because they're sending all of their criminals to the United States of America. Now, think of it. Next year, what we'll do? Oh, if they win, I never want to say, you know, I never say, we're going to win. They cheat like hell. We got to get out. We got to, too big to rig and all that stuff. But if they ever got in, we will have another meeting. We'll do it in Venezuela because it'll be much safer than any place in the United States. Because by that time, we'll have all the criminals from all over the world in our country, because that's what's happening. You're not going to teach a criminal not to be a criminal. It's just not going to happen. Maybe a little bit, but you're not going to happen. One of the countries, the president of the country, I don't want to really mention the name, but he's a nice guy. I know every one of them. They're very smart people. They're very sharp. They're at the top of their game. Our guy was not at the top, and this one is just, she never could be. By the way, lousy student, failed her law exam, said, you know that she couldn't pass her bar. She couldn't pass her bar exams. Okay, does anyone know that? They're not going to do. They say that on NBC News. Ladies and gentlemen, we have breaking news. Kamala Harris could not pass her bar exams. But she's going to be a great president, right? No, she couldn't pass a bar exam. She couldn't pass anything. Couldn't pass everything. She couldn't pass anything. But just think of this. These countries, and if I were the head of one of the countries, I would be worse than any of them. I mean, some of them actually have half of their prison population still. I wouldn't have any. Richard wouldn't have any. You and I would, our country would be the safest country. Every criminal would be in the United States of America. I can tell Richard Childress. Every criminal would already be here. Every jail would be empty. Every mental institution, insane asylum would be empty. They'd all be in the United States. And that's what, in a short period of time, that's what's going to happen. We're going to have all of their criminals. The only thing good about them is they make our criminals look like very nice people by comparison. These are serious criminals. These are rough killers. But under Border Czar Harris, can you believe it? Our communities are being ravaged by migrant crime. I call it migrant crime. I used to call it Biden migrant crime, but now I'll probably change it to Harris or Kamala. You know, it took him about, what, 4 years to pronounce her name right, and then she did an overthrow. That was a very undemocratic move, wasn't it? Earlier this year, a 15-year-old girl in Massachusetts was raped by a migrant who Biden and Harris flew into the United States against all orders. In upstate New York 2 months ago, another 15-year-old girl was attacked by an illegal alien that just walked into our country, assaulted with a metal pipe, abducted, driven to an isolated area, raped and killed. And in Texas last month, 12-year-old Jocelyn Nungari was tied up, sexually assaulted, and strangled to death by two illegal aliens who Biden and Harris released into the United States and refused to get them out. What kind of a vice president or what kind of a border czar allows these monsters to come into our country? And this is just a small portion. These people are here now by the hundreds of thousands. And remember this, it's like anything else. They're just getting comfortable. They've just gotten here a little while ago. So you haven't seen the kind of crime that's going to be inflicted on our country. They're just getting comfortable. They're getting used to being here. They don't know about the words politically correct yet when you catch them and you do nothing, and then you catch them again and do nothing. They don't know. The only time they do something, if it happens to be Trump, because he talks about how the rigged election was a disgrace. Oh, he should get the electric chair because he said the election was rigged. But if you rape and kill somebody and strangle them and dump them in a creek, that's okay with these people because they're crazy. And we don't want these people running our country anymore. What kind of person allows innocent American girls to be raped and murdered while keeping our border wide open? Never change it. Never change it. You know, they passed for the election about 2 weeks ago. They passed something that's meaningless. It's absolutely meaningless. But you know that, Brandon. They said they passed some nonsense so that they could have a news. We're having a news conference. It actually made it worse. It actually, look at me saying it did. It made it worse. It's horrible. Kamala's deadly destruction of America's borders is completely and totally disqualifying. She shouldn't even be allowed to run for president, what she's done. She's committing crimes. No person who deliberately lets these kind of savage criminals into America should ever be trusted with power again, should ever be trusted to be the president of our country. If Border Czar Harris stays in charge, every week will bring a never-ending stream of illegal alien rapists, bloodthirsty killers, and child predators to go after our sons and our daughters. That's what's going to happen. Everybody knows that. You're not going to talk these people into being wonderful citizens. If I'm elected, we will immediately deputize local police who are dying to do the job, by the way, but their power has been taken away. And we'll form a massive dragnet to scour the nation for the monsters who are murdering and raping children all over the world. Many of them have come here because they're looking for them in their own countries for rape, for murder, for all sorts of things. And we will ship them back to the country from which they came. We're going to get them out of here. You know, when I first came here, I don't tell this much, but you couldn't get them back. I said, well, we're going to get them out. MS-13 in particular, the most savage, vicious gang. They killed two 16-year-old girls walking to school. They killed them with a knife. They sliced up their body. They didn't want to use a gun because that's too quick. They didn't want to use a gun. They sliced them up. They sliced them up into pieces. They killed them. And Nancy Pelosi said they should stand trial, you know, nice, fair trial. No, these are monsters. But when I first came here, I said, we're going to get these people out, MS-13, and the general came up to Sir President Obama at the time. President Obama has been trying for 4 years. President Bush has been trying. They've all been trying. The countries won't accept them. They don't want their MS-13 back. I said, really? You can't get it back? No, sir. What they do is they put major big aircraft, commercial aircraft, on their runways so that when we're getting nearby, we can't land, sir. And then they clog up the roads. Right, Brandon? They clog up. He knows because he was trying to send them back. They couldn't send them back. Then they clog up the roads so the buses and cars, every way, you can't get back into their countries. And they tell the people, we'll give you the death penalty if you come back in. Other than that, they're quite friendly, actually. So I said, really? They won't accept them. Yes, sir, we have to live with them. I said, we're not going to live with them. I asked, how much money do, like, Honduras and Guatemala, El Salvador, Mexico, how much money do they get from us for economic development and aid? Sure, we pay them $750 million a year. Now, that's peanuts compared to all, but still a lot of money. We pay them $750 million a year, sir. I said, tell them that we're not paying any more. They're in default. We're not giving them the money. We're not giving them any more money, Brandon. We're not giving. You were there, right? You were there. So we notified them, you're not getting any more money. The three countries in particular, El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras, rough countries. And they were sending all of their criminals into our country. They said, we're sending them back. And you're not going to put any airplanes on the runway, and you're not going to clog up the roads. We're sending them back. But I said, how much money? $750 million. Inform them that they're not getting any more money. There's no more aid. We call it aid because we're stupid. We call it aid. You're not getting any more aid. There will be no more aid to your country. And the next morning, I got a call separately from all three presidents of these countries. They're very streetwise guy. They're very streetwise people. And they called me. And they said, sir, there must be a misunderstanding. I said, what's up? He goes, sir, you have stopped sending our aid to us. I said, that's right, because you're not letting the criminals that you sent in caravans and otherwise, you sent into our country, you're not letting them go back to your country because we said, well, sir, I'd like to talk about that. We would be delighted to take MS-13 back into our country. And all three countries the same exact. And we sent them back, Tom Homan and all our guys, right? And That guy right there. We sent them back at record levels like nobody's ever seen. Stand up, Brandon. Brandon Judd. Right, Brandon? We sent them back. Brandon was shocked because he, you know, he was the head of the Border Patrol. And I'll tell you a little secret. He's not supposed to endorse anybody. He's really not. But he got so fed up with the incompetent people that when I ran, he said, I don't care. I'm endorsing Trump. I said, you're not supposed to do it. I said, I don't. And he never wavered, did he? He never wavered. Him and his whole group of people, they're incredible. These are incredible people. You know, it's much easier for him not to do the job. But they don't want that. They want to straighten out our country. They love the country as much as anybody in this room. They want to work. It's risky. It's dangerous. They don't want to not do their job. They want to make our borders strong and our country safe. And we're going to be doing that in 6 months. We're going to be doing that. You know, unfortunately, we have to wait till January 20th. But I can tell you that November 5th will be the most important day in the history of our country. We're going to take our country back from these lunatics. During her entire time as border czar, Kamala has not had a single conversation with the chief of Border Patrol or the unions or anybody. Did they ever call you? Did they ever call Brandon Judd, please? Get him on the phone. Brandon, how are we doing on the border? I used to call. He goes, horrible. How are we doing on the border, Brandon? We're doing, he just goes, horrible. But I'd call you all the time, right? I'd say, how the hell are we doing, Brandon? And we were doing great. That's why the chart, right? But we were doing great. But they talked to the four top people on the border. Have you ever spoken to Biden? Biden doesn't know he's alive. You know, the head of the FBI was, you know that, right? He was in front of Congress today. And one of the great congressmen asked him a question. Have you ever noticed in all your meetings with Biden that he's cognitively a degenerate? And he said, no, I never noticed that. I never noticed that. No, no, really, there was nothing to talk about. I never noticed that. Now, anybody that says that, you know they're not telling the truth. It's a very serious thing. It's a very serious thing. No, I didn't notice. I didn't notice. No, I didn't notice. I didn't notice he couldn't stand up. I didn't notice he can't walk. And I didn't notice he can't think and he couldn't talk. Other than that, he's doing quite well, however. Thank you. No, he didn't notice. That's a very bad thing. Well, a very bad thing. A very sick thing. We're pleased to be joined today by former president of the National Border Patrol. And that's the man I've just been talking about. He's been so incredible. The patrol counsel, the head guy and the boss, Brandon Judd. Thank you, Brandon. Thank you. And Brandy, can you come up and say a couple of words? We have time. Do we have time? Come on, Brandon Judd. Come on, Brandon.
And I'll bet you he can beat me up those. I'll bet you he can beat me up those stairs. Remember when Biden challenged him to a golf match, and yet Trump was just playing with Bryson DeChambeau? You beat him, didn't you? Look. I lived this. I lived this. Under five presidents, never have we seen a more secure border. You know this. This isn't a secret. The most secure border we've ever had was under Donald Trump. The less... We had fewer drug overdoses under Donald Trump. We had fewer criminal aliens under Donald Trump. Like he said in 2019, zero known terrorists. That number has jumped up more than 100% under Joe Biden. 100%. Yeah. Yeah, that's what we're seeing right now. This was amazing. It was all about policy. October 7th, 2016, the day of Access Hollywood. Come on. Locker talk, seriously? And they thought that that was going to bring him down. We did a press conference with Donald Trump, October 7th. 2016, because it was about policy. That's what it's about. If we have proper policy, we can secure the border and we can keep your children, your grandchildren, your great-grandchildren safe. He can do that. He can do it. They refuse. Kamala Harris knows what she needs to do. I was there. I gave her all of the policies that she needed, all of them, and she refused to implement them. She does not care about you. She does not care about the safety of this country. He does. This is the man for the presidency.
Thank you. Wow. That was great. Thank you, Brandon. Thank you very much. He does some job. He does some job. Now that she's running for president, Kamala is suddenly trying to transform her personality to pretend she is tough on crime. She's so bad on crime. In fact, Kamala Harris was the original Marxist district attorney. She was the first of them. You know, you hear all about them in Philadelphia and Los Angeles. She was the first. She was worse than any of them. She supports ending cash bail nationwide. She wants no bail. If you murder somebody, just go home and relax. Murder a couple of other people. Which means releasing violent criminals immediately after arrest. She supports stripping police officers of legal protections, ending jail sentences for parole violators. And in 2020, she helped raise $35 million to bail out criminals released from jail after they shot at our police, looted stores, sexually assaulted innocent victims, and committed many other very serious crimes. She was giving them money and bailing them out. One of the dangerous criminals Kamala helped bail out of jail was Sean Michael Tillman. You know that name, a repeat offender who, with Harris's help, was set free. He then went on to murder a man on a train platform in St. Paul, Minnesota, shooting him in cold blood 6 times, lying on the ground. Shot him in the head and in the torso 6 times. Kamala Harris wants to be the president for savage criminals, illegal aliens. I will be the president for law-abiding Americans of every race, religion, color, and creed. And I will stop the Democrats' party war. Remember this. The Democrats, they have a war going with police. They have a war. They don't want to talk about it, but they want it. The Democrat Party has a war on with police. We will stand up to the Marxist district attorneys. Defund the police. That's what they want. Defund. They want to defund. She wants to defund the police. Now, she's pulled back on it, but that's where she is going. I don't even... Does anybody even understand the concept? That's like open borders. That's like men and women sports. The same thing. I think it's maybe even crazier than any of them. We will give our police back their power, protection, respect that they deserve. We're going to give them back the respect that they deserve. Today, I am honored to receive the official endorsement of the National Association of Police Organizations, which is the largest in our country. It represents 250,000 police officers nationwide. It's such an honor to get it. To me, that's a great honor. To me, that's something that means the largest anywhere in the United States. It's the greatest people. I'd like to ask their president, Mick McHale, to come up and say a few words, please. Thank you. Thank you, Mick.
Ladies and gentlemen, I am truly honored to stand before you today, and on behalf of the National Association of Police Organizations, I am pleased to formally announce NAPO's endorsement of Donald J. Trump for President of the United States. If I may, as president, President Trump directed the Attorney General to aggressively prosecute those who attack officers for simply being in a uniform. President Trump, he signed the Law Enforcement Mental Health and Wellness Act. And ladies and gentlemen, that's protecting the protectors. President Trump also signed the ability for surplus military equipment to once again be used to protect you, the citizens, not to take your rights. And one of the most important things that the president did, he recognized that the men and women who provide public safety, who are part of law enforcement, deserve the same constitutional rights as the people we serve. Mr. President, once again, we are proud and pleased to support your campaign, and we are here for anything that you ever may need. God bless you, and God bless the United States of America.
Thank you very much. That's a big one. That's something that means a lot to all of us in this room. It's no wonder the Democrat Party and their thugs are so desperate to stop us. They know that we are the only ones who can stop them. We're the only ones. This is it. This is the big election coming up. This is it. This is going to be the biggest of them all. All of their persecution is only happening because I'm running for president and leading big in the polls, every one of them. And we're not just leading against Kamala, we're also leading against everyone, including big leads right here in the great state of North Carolina. We have a big lead. We have a big, beautiful lead. The radical left Democrats rigged the presidential election in 2020, and we're not going to allow them to rig the presidential election in 2024. You. Right, Michael? Every time the radical left Democrats, Marxists, communists, and fascists indict me, I consider it truly a great badge of honor. I never thought I'd be saying that, but I consider it a badge of honor because I'm being indicted for you. And never forget, our enemies want to take away my freedom because I will never, ever let them take away your freedom. I'll never let it happen. They want to silence me because I will never let them silence you. And in the end, they're not after me, they're after you. I just happen to be standing in their way, and I always will. Thank you. Thank you. We're pleased to be joined tonight by many great North Carolina patriots, including Congressman Richard Hudson. Where is Richard? Richard Hudson, Richard. He's a big, wonderful, wonderful guy, wonderful warrior, Richard. Thank you. A man who I've just been involved in from the day he first went in, I endorsed him. Everyone said, who is he? Turned out to be an incredible congressman, but now he's running for attorney general, and he's going to be your next attorney general, Dan Bishop. Where's Dan? Dan. Thank you, Dan. Thank you, Dan. Good for him. He's incredible. Great job. And you were a great guy. Richard, we're going to miss him in Congress, but that's okay. Great, great luck, Dan. Congressional candidates, Addison McDowell. Big victory, Addison. They're way ahead in the polls. Brad Knott. Thank you, Brad. Pat Harrigan. Thank you. Thank you, Pat. Good. Mark Harris. They like you. And the Speaker of the North Carolina House, a man who's done an incredible job. He gets it. He gets it. He really gets it. Tim Moore. Thank you, Tim. And when it came time to pick a chairman of the Republican National Committee and Convention and everything else having to do with national politics, I came to a man named Michael Whatley of North Carolina. And the reason is because at 10 o'clock in the evening, when we all had those televisions on, and I saw weird things happening, drops at 3:02 in the morning and all the things that were happening, North Carolina held totally steady. He had 602 lawyers working. He held it steady. And other states, I was leading by a lot, and all of a sudden, people went to sleep. They thought that was over. And I said, no, because I know how bad these people are. But North Carolina had held steady. He was the head of your Republicans in North Carolina, did a phenomenal job. So I immediately called him. I said, let's do it. And I got him. Please stand up. Please stand up. You have done a fantastic job. Fantastic. And working with Laura Trump, what a team that is, right? She's doing a good job, right? And I said, don't worry about the votes. Just guard the votes, right? Just guard. We have all the votes you need. Just guard the votes. And he's doing that, and he's doing it at levels that nobody's seen before. And I hope we're going to have a big, beautiful surprise, because we're not going to let them steal this election. And they didn't do it in North Carolina. Thank you. Thank you, Michael. Great job. A wonderful gentleman who I met a little while ago, Michael Verardo, and he is a wounded warrior and just a highly respected guy. Michael, wherever you may be. Michael? Hi, Michael. Wow. You look good. I'm not messing with you, Michael. Wow. Good-looking guy. Thanks, Michael. Great, great patriot, great person. Members of the Charlotte Police Department are here. Please stand up. You are phenomenal. What a job. What a job they do. Thank you. What a job they do. Thank you very much. And chief of the Catawba Nation, Brian Harris. Brian, where are you, Brian? They've been so supportive. They've been so supportive. Thank you very much. From the moment we take back the White House from Kamala Harris, they switch. It's every day. Next week they'll have somebody else when they find out how bad she is. She's worse than he is. But when we take it back from Kamala and crooked Joe Biden, the most crooked president we've ever had, I believe we are going to have the four greatest years in the history of our country. We're going to do it. We're going to do it. Starting on day one, we will end inflation and make America affordable again. Inflation is killing our people. They've got inflation. I think real inflation is closer to 50%. They like to say 23, 24%. No, they don't add everything. I think, look at interest rates. They're through the roof. Nobody can buy a house. You can't get the money even if you want it. To bring down the prices of all goods, we will stop the Biden-Harris war on American energy, and we will drill, baby, drill. That includes racing car. You know, that's good. You're going to spend a lot less money for your gasoline. You have that special stuff. I will terminate the Green News scam, and I will end the Biden-Harris electric vehicle mandate on day one. And we already gave you the largest tax cuts in history, but we will pass massive tax cuts for workers, and that includes, remember, no tax on tips. No tax on tips. No tax on tips. To protect North Carolina workers, I will revoke China's most favored nation status. Think of it. They're most favored because they're a developing nation. Well, we're a developing nation, too, because we've gone to hell and back. We're a developing nation, too. They are considered a developing nation, so they get advantages that we don't get. Not going to happen. And I will pass the Trump Reciprocal Trade Act. That means that if China or any other country makes us pay a 100 or 200% tariff or tax, we will make them pay a reciprocal tariff or tax of 100 or 200% immediately, right back. It's basically you hurt us and we hurt you, an eye for an eye. Look at it any way you want. Before I even arrive at the Oval Office, shortly after we, the people in this room, win the presidency, I will have the horrible war between Russia and Ukraine settled. We're going to get it settled quickly. I'll do it as president-elect, I'll do it. And I will be doing something that nobody else even talks about. We have never been so close. I will prevent World War III. We're heading to World War III. We're heading right into the teeth of it because we have stupid people representing us, and they're being represented against people that are at the top of their game. I will restore peace through strength, which is what we have. And in my next term, we will build a great Iron Dome missile defense shield over our country, a dome the likes of which nobody has ever seen before. And it will be entirely made in the USA. You know, Ronald Reagan wanted to do that, but honestly, it's a long time ago. We didn't have the technology. Now we have the greatest technology in the world. And in case there's a problem, we're going to be stopping them, but we're going to have the best in the world. It's all going to be made right here. I will not cut one penny from Social Security or Medicare, and I will not raise the retirement age. One day, I won't even raise it by one day. And, you know, they're talking about, he was talking about, she's talking about lifting the retirement age. She's going to have to because they're putting a lot of the illegal aliens that are coming into our country. They're going into Social Security and Medicare. They're going into a hospital. We're not going to raise it one penny or one day. I kept that promise, remember, for 4 years. For 4 years, they said, oh, he's going to raise Social Security. No, for 4 years, I didn't, and I won't do it. I'm the one that won't do it. And remember, I said something else. I'm going to keep you out of wars. I kept you out of wars. We had no wars with Donald Trump as your president. We defeated ISIS. We beat ISIS in 4 weeks as opposed to 5 years, which is was supposed to take. Remember this, our military is great. They're not woke. The guys on top, the political guys are woke, but they can't convince them. I saw ISIS dissolve before us once I put the military on it, once they had the commander-in-chief behind them. We have great generals, and it is not woke. They're not woke. They won't be woke. They can't be talked into being woke. They'd leave before that happens. But we have people on the top that are woke, and they're all gone. We're going to get rid of them so fast. We're going to rebuild our cities into beacons of hope, safety, and beauty better than they've ever been before. We'll have to work with Democrat governors and mayors in many cases, but we're going to rebuild our cities. They're crime-ridden, horribly run places right now. We're going to clean them up, and we're going to do something that's really good, and we're going to take our nation's capital in Washington, D.C. We're going to clean it up, renovate it. We're going to rebuild our capital city so that it is no longer a nightmare of murder and crime, but rather it will become the most beautiful capital anywhere in the world. We're going to take over the management, the leadership of it. Right now, you go from North Carolina, let's go and see the Washington Monument on the assumption that they don't change the name, which they want to. They want to change the Jefferson Memorial. Not going to happen. Remember when we were having a problem in Washington where they were trying to knock down some of our monuments, and I passed a bill? And the bill said, if you touch a monument, if we catch you even in the act, you go to jail for 10 years. And there's no 10 years equal 1 year. It's 10 years. You serve 10 years. And it was amazing. I looked outside the beautiful White House windows. I looked outside, and people were just leaving town. It was an incredible thing. I took old legislation that, frankly, you could never pass, very old, 1926. And I restored it, and I said, 10 years, if you take down that, and they were all getting ready. They had ropes around the necks of these gorgeous pieces of art. I said, you do that, you go into jail for 10 years. And they left those ropes hanging. They couldn't get out of town fast enough. On day one, I will sign a new executive order to cut federal funding for any school pushing critical race theory, transgender insanity, and other inappropriate racial, sexual, or political content onto the shoulders of our children. And I will not give one penny to any school that has a vaccine mandate or a mask mandate. And I will keep men out of women's sports, and I will fully uphold our great Second Amendment. We will protect innocent life, and we will restore very quickly free speech. And I will secure our elections. Finally, we're going to get them secured. Our goal will be one-day voting with paper ballots, proof of citizenship, and voter ID. But until then, Republicans must win. We want a landslide that's just, and it is really an expression that's used. It's very tough for them. Too big to rig. We're way ahead. We're way ahead by more than even the polls say. We have to make it so big, Richard, that they can't do it. There's not a thing they're going to be able to do about it. So too big to win. You have to get out there and vote. Get everybody. Get everybody. Get them all. Remember this. It's a strange thing. Evangelicals, Christians, they don't vote very much. We got to vote. They got to vote. They're great. They're such great people. Gun owners, the NRA, you know, gave us their total endorsement. But gun owners don't vote. They tend not to vote. We have to get them to vote. If we could get the evangelicals, Christians, if we can get gun owners to vote, it's not even an election. But they got to get out. So get your people at church to vote, okay? If you want to save America, get your friends, get your family. Get everyone you know and vote. Vote early. Vote absentee. Vote election day. I don't care how you vote. You got to get out. You got to vote. And make sure your vote counts. Follow your vote. Check your vote. Check it. You can do it. Check your vote that they don't rob you of your vote. Such an important thing. And if you want to help ensure election integrity, sign up at protectthevote.com. Protectthevote.com. And watch those people. Make sure they don't cheat. Michael's doing a great job, and you just watch him, Michael. From Asheville to Raleigh, and this is, I have to tell you, an incredible group of people, the spirit, the incredible spirit. We have so much to say, but in conclusion, from Asheville to Raleigh, from Greensboro to Greenville, from Wilmington to right here in Charlotte, this state was forged by some of the toughest men and some of the strongest women ever to walk the face of the earth. Our American ancestors were backcountry farmers and frontier settlers, woodsmen, craftsmen, workers and warriors who poured their love into this land, and they loved their families and they wanted to take care of their families at all costs. They climbed the mountains, fought the battles, conquered the dangers, tamed the unknown wilderness, built the factories and gave everything they had to make America into the greatest nation in the history of the world. But now we are a nation in decline. We are a nation in decline. Can you believe it? We are a failing nation. We are a nation that has lost its confidence, lost its willpower, and lost its strength. We are a nation that has quite simply lost its way. But we are not going to allow this horror to continue. Less than 4 years ago, we were a great nation, and we will soon be a great nation again. We'll be a great nation again. With our leadership, every disaster Joe Biden and Kamala Harris have created can be fixed and can be fixed very quickly. Every problem can be solved and every wrong can be rectified. By this time next year, America's borders will be strong, sealed, and secure. Inflation will be in full retreat. Our economy will be roaring back. Optimism will be surging. The American dream will will be thriving citizens of every race, religion, color, and creed. Law and justice will reign all throughout our land. Freedom will be restored. The flame of liberty will be burning bright. Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, the worst administration in the history of our country, will be a fading memory of the past. And our great silent majority, including the once forgotten men and women of our country, will be the one shaping America's magnificent future when I am the 47th President of the United States. Because we are all Americans, and together we will show November 5th to be the most important day in the history of our country. There will never have been a more important day, because if we don't do the right thing, and if it doesn't work out, it's got to work out. If it doesn't work out, we won't have a country. We're going to have a great country again. We're going to have a great country again. We are one movement, one people, one family, and one glorious nation under God. And together we will make America powerful again. We will make America wealthy again. We will make America strong again. We will make America proud again. We will make America safe again. We will make America free again. And we will make America great again. Thank you very much. Thank you. God bless you all. Thank you.